big business entertainment phenomenon of the year has been a bunch of middle-aged Englishmen called the Rolling Stones. Twenty years after they started, they're more successful, in purely commercial terms, than ever before. Their lengthy American tour before Christmas earned them an estimated £60 million as they played to stadium after stadium, packed with tens of thousands of curious teenagers who'd come to see the ever-athletic Jagger and hear the songs that were once anthems for rebellion and are now predictable but sometimes still rousing good-time party music. This summer, the Rolling Stones machine has been lumbering equally successfully around Europe on the band's first visit here for 6 years. They play the same songs, usually in exactly the same order, on the same vast purple stage. Sometimes with the old energy, and always for the same vast crowds. It's mass entertainment on a vast scale. 40 shows in 55 days in 10 countries, an audience of over 2 million who have paid around £10 each for a ticket. 32 giant trucks carry two sets of light and sound and carry some of the 150-strong touring party who aren't in the band's chartered plane. It's an elaborate operation with very big money at stake. But in the middle of it all, the Stones actually seem to be enjoying themselves. Until the last couple of weeks, Jagger went running every morning. In America, he explained how fit he has to be.
Well, it depends on what show you're in, start off with. But I mean, if you're not. I was in reasonable shape, not good shape, but I was reasonable, you know. So I had to work about 2 months to get into shape to do it. But then, if you're on the road for 3 months, you've got to stay there, you know, you can't just dip off.
So what do you do? I mean, lots of
Well, on the days off, stuff. A lot of running and on the days off, which is, like, just what you want to do on the days off. You really want to stay in bed, you've got to go out running.
Do you enjoy touring still, or do you find it boring, the whole sort of travelling and the...
No, well, this part is pretty good fun, you know, really. It can get dull, but, you know, it's as dull or as interesting as you make it, I think, like most things.
One of the main reasons that we're still playing together, you know, is that we actually enjoy playing together, you know, and still it's fun for us. You know, it's like a very well-paid hobby.
No, there's a whole lot more laughing going on now, which was... I mean, I don't want to make it a sort of party band, you know, but... It was getting too serious.
16, 19. In a gym backstage at a giant sports stadium in Cologne, Germany, Bill Wyman plays table tennis with keyboard player Chuck Lavelle minutes before the Stones go on. When the band appeared at Wembley last month, Wyman played John McEnroe, who beat him once, then refused a further game.
Yeah, this is my toning up, if you like. Mick has to do exercises and stretches and things, and I always make sure there's a table tennis table backstage, and there's quite a few good players in around the crew and everything. The band aren't very good, but a lot of other people are.
Is that a sort of calming thing to do just before you go on to an enormous stadium like now?
Well, I sweat it out here and then take a rest when I go on stage.
The musical and business phenomenon of the Rolling Stones began 20 years ago, in July 1962, in a cellar club beneath the Academy Cinema in London's Oxford Street. Today it's the site of the Academy 2, but in the early 60s there was a jazz club there called The Marquee. Trad jazz was still popular in Britain, though its more commercial offshoot, skiffle, had boomed and then faded. It was time for something new. The club's newsletter of May 62 announced a new sound, Rhythm and Blues, the black American electric guitar blues of Chicago, the music of Muddy Waters and Chuck Berry. A white English band, Alexis Corner's Blues Incorporated, set out to play the new music. The band's drummer was a certain Charles Watts. Later, the band were to add a singer called Mick Jagger, a student at the London School of Economics, whose image was something quite new on the jazz scene.
The thing that fascinated was the way his hair swung. You used to see Mick moving his head and the hair would swing backwards. It wasn't all that long, but it moved, it swung. And it was quite an extraordinary thing because no one else had moving hair.
What sort of person was Jagger in those early days?
Slightly grumpy, which hasn't changed, has it? I mean, you know, he can be. Mick can be grumpy if he wants to. But very, very much into... He was in it for the music. He really was in it for the music. And he and Keith were always together. I mean, they were the couple... They were the lads from Dartford who used to come in every week and come down to the Ealing Club, or we used to live in Moscow Road then, which is all of 500 yards from where we're sitting now. And we had a kitchen window which certain people knew how to open and used to get up in the morning sometimes and find about five bodies stretched out on the kitchen floor.
On July the 12th, 1962, Blues Incorporated found they had a problem. They were booked to play at the Marquee, where they had a Thursday night residency. But they'd also been invited to appear on the BBC Light Programme's Jazz Club, though the BBC had complained that a seven-piece band was too large and they'd have to be slimmed down to six.
Bookings had come back and said, why do you have to have seven people in your band?
This was BBC Bookings
complaining. This was BBC
Bookings
complaining that we had three singers and they weren't prepared to pay for three singers. They would only pay for two singers, especially as the two singers played instruments. And the third singer was just a gash singer who didn't play anything, so they really didn't feel like paying for seven. So we had this... We didn't want to drop Mick from the thing because he was a regular band singer. We
so
had
the BBC wouldn't
meeting.
Have Mick Jagger playing.
They wouldn't
with
pay for Mick. They wouldn't pay for Mick because they couldn't see the reason for a third singer. And we really didn't want to do the broadcast without Mick. We really didn't want to. But at the same time, we felt it was very important to do the broadcast if we're going to spread R&B. A chance of a broadcast was quite something. So what was decided in the end was Mick would get the Rolling Stones together because Keith was around always. So we thought of Mick and Keith. And they'd met Brian Jones by then, because Brian, I met in Cheltenham sometime before and had introduced them to them. And Mick and Keith and Brian and Ian Stewart and possibly Dick Taylor on bass, I don't know, I'm not sure about that, and I don't know who on drums, got the Rolling Stones together to hold the Marquee open on the Thursday for us.
So the Rolling Stones played for the first time, though without Charlie, who was off at the BBC with Alexis, and without Bill Wyman. 6 months later, they had a residency at the club. Since the early 60s, the Marquee has moved a few hundred yards southeast to Wardour Street. It's still something of a rough-and-ready showcase for aspiring bands, and it still has the same owner, Harold Pendleton. He doesn't remember the Stones as an overnight success.
The only occasion I can actually remember the Rolling Stones is the night they were fired, actually. That sticks in my mind.
They were fired?
Fired, yes, because they came back later with Cyril Davis, who had taken over the residency from Alexis, who had gone off to another club. And Cyril ran for Thursdays with the Rolling Stones as the support group. And I can always remember the night I came out of the club with Cyril walking along the street, and I saw the Stones the other side of the road loading and liking them. I said, good night, you know, cheers, good night. And a sort of snarl of rage came back to me. I said, oh, God, what's the matter with them? And Cyril said, I've just fired them. I said, you've done what? He said, oh, I sacked them. He said, they don't play all that well. I can get a better blues group.
How much would they have been paid when they were the support to Cyril Davis?
In 1963, £10 a night.
The Stones' ambition, as far as it went when it started, was three or four good club gigs around London, just enough to keep the amplifiers going and keep yourself in guitar strings and play rhythm and blues to English audiences. But up until then, we considered nobody had really done that, you know. And but we couldn't see it getting any bigger than three or four back rooms of pubs, you know. We certainly weren't in it for the money, you know. We wanted to preach the gospel of rhythm and blues. It's like idealistic kids, you know.
Well, I had another group in South London, and my drummer answered an ad for a drummer, because they'd tried out all kinds of people, and Charlie wouldn't join them. He was with Alexis Corner and people like that. And so my drummer went up, and he came back, and he said, they haven't got a bass player either. Why don't you come up on Wednesday? So I went up with him, and we got the job. And then he got fired, and I stayed. And then we got Charlie. So there we were.
And what was the aim, and your aim in the very early days then, to play what sort of things?
Just to earn a couple of quid more a week, I think it was, you know, tax-free.
So when did you first get ambitious?
When I realised I might be able to move into a flat with a toilet on the inside, you know, instead of in the garden. I thought, this is it, folks. Never look back.
Baby bag, dressed in black. Silver buttons all down her back.
The Lower West Side, New York, is where the Rolling Stones' first manager now lives, in a graffiti-covered block that's threatened with demolition. Giorgio Gemelski, record producer and club DJ, used to run the Crawdaddy Club in Richmond and became known as the Diogelef of rhythm and blues for the help he gave young London bands like the Kinks, the Yardbirds and the Stones, whom he never asked to sign a contract. They were later assigned to a second manager, Andrew Luke Oldham.
See, Brian and Keith had gone out on a limb. Brian, particularly because he was from Cheltenham, so he had no connection with London. He had no family in London or anything. Keith had family, and Mick had family in London. So they were kind of looked after pretty well by their mothers. You know, I remember Keith's mother used to bring fresh shirts once a week to Edith Grove, you know, infamous house in Edith Grove. You know.
In those early days, what did you hope it was all going to lead to?
I thought that perhaps for the first time, artists could take over their own business. That's really what I thought. You know, the great potential of that moment would have been if all of us at the time, I was the one doing all the talking, and I was, cause you know, a little bit laughed at. You can imagine my thick accent trying to convince people in England, all places, you know, to get together and to do something that had smacked a little bit of constructivist Russian art, you know, or Bauhaus, or you know what I mean. So let's all get together. Let's have our own agency. Let's exchange our information. Let's be a kind of an artist cooperative.
Gemelski's idealistic concept of a multimedia artist cooperative never happened. Instead, the Stones became very famous. The unofficial archivist of their rise is Bill Wyman.
I only basically started doing it for the sake of my kid. I thought it might be nice when he gets to 15 to say my dad once was on television and made two records and played two shows or something. And there's a scrapbook, you know, but then it escalated.
But you've now become a sort of collector of memorabilia for...
Well, I just carried on, really, because nobody else bothered, and I thought at one time it might be worth doing to donate to a museum or something as a cultural thing, you know, and because I was talking to Paul of the Beatles once, and I said, you're supposed to have amazing archives, and he says, we haven't got nothing. And I showed him a couple of videos of some of their early shows in America, which he'd never seen before, and I thought, oh. And they started collecting from that day, and I've been collecting all along, and it's very difficult to hang on to it now because everybody's after it.
You've become also a walking dictionary of what happened on what dates. Is this just something you've always had a memory for, knowing exactly what happened when?
Yeah, I have a good memory, and Keith has a very good memory as well. Mick is hopeless, and so is Charlie. And of course, Woody's only been with us for 7 years. I mean, he's a new boy, he doesn't know much.
So when was the first time the Rolling Stones were filmed in colour?
Oh, no, a minute. 7 minutes film of Pathé Pictorial at the Hull ABC Theatre. September 64, I think.
And the song?
Just before the Tammy show, which was in black and white in America. The song was Around and Around.
I see the joint was rocking. Around and round, yeah, reeling out.
By 1964, when Jagger started working on his athletic, balletic, erotic stage act, with a slightly ungainly imitation of the great black American singer James Brown, the Stones were already causing riots.
Well, we weren't as commercial as the Beatles, and we didn't make such good records or write such good songs as them, you know, but we played better on stage. That's the difference. The Stones were always better on stage than they were on record. So when people came to see us, they really got impressed and always came to see us again. Whereas when they came to see bands like The Searchers and the Merseybeats and those kind of bands that were around, and Dave Clark Five, they were disappointed by the on-stage performance. The records were good, but so they thought, you know. But the on-stage thing didn't happen, so we always won over everybody in that way. We always had great crowds coming to see us.
Well, this could be the last time. This could be the last time, maybe the last time I found out. Oh no.
The Stones couldn't go on wildly rehashing the blues forever. Like the Beatles, they had to learn to write their own material. Jagger and Richards had to be like Lennon and McCartney.
Up until that point, a songwriter was almost as divorced to me from what I did as a blacksmith or a drummer. You know, I mean, I'm a guitar player, that's what I did, and that's what I considered what I was good for. I didn't conceive the fact that I could write songs. And so Angela Oldham locked me in a kitchen with Mick for two nights and said, come out with a song, you know. And
so how did you go about doing it? Just by doing it?
Yeah, he kind of put it to us like that, come out with a song, you know. And we said, okay, log it in and we'll try it. You know, I think you're barking up the wrong tree. I'm just going to see how we're going to...
You didn't see it at all?
No, I was sure. But once you've written the first one, then it's easy. Yeah. Oh, it's not easy, but it's, at least you know that you can do it.
The final ingredient in the heady Stones cocktail in the 60s was their image and their very attitude. Rebellious, anti-establishment, scruffy individual, just one step ahead of the whole 60s counterculture upheaval. But were they just being themselves, or was it all carefully planned?
We didn't wear stage uniforms, the first band ever not to, because we didn't have the money for them, really, and we didn't care about them. And at that time, we were refused to like rebookings at places because we didn't wear makeup and get into stage clothes. You know, we used to arrive at a gig and the guy would say, you're late, you haven't got your makeup on, you haven't changed or anything. And we'd say, well, no, we're not, we're early, we're ready. Do you want us to go on now? No, you have 10 more minutes, you know, so we're always early for gigs.
So it wasn't a deliberately tailored anti-image, it was just
the way
you were?
No, it was just come off the street and onto the stage, really. And it was, if they like it, great, and if they don't, we use it as a rehearsal.
I'm pretty sure that Andy Oldham and Mick, with the knowledge of Keith, certainly, and Charlie, but not necessarily particular input, planned the bad boy image very carefully and very deliberately as the antidote to the goodness of the Beatles. It was to be the reaction. Now, it was the, you don't want to be goodies, come and join us. And it was planned and it worked beautifully. At the same time, they wrote the sort of songs that totally suited their image. I mean, absolutely and completely. It was, I think, the best conceived and executed image job of any of them. It's held good for 20 years as an image.
An image for bad times as well as good. image and music has changed subtly with every era. They paid homage to peace, love and hippiedom, while giving the impression that maybe they were a little too wild and tough for all that. So when the hippie fantasies fell apart, they could provide the soundtrack for the more brutal side of the 70s. From the Vietnam War to their own personal tragedies, the murders of the free concert at Altamont, or the mysterious death of the Stones' founder member, Brian Jones. They were startling, sensual, disturbing, and never too specific about their beliefs. People could read into them what they wanted.
People sort of used them rather like a like a Chinese wall on which you could secretly go up and write any slogan you like at night about anybody, and the next morning the whole world can read it. And I mean, Mick or Keith are sort of blank walls on which you put your image. And if they don't behave the way you think they should, you then complain that they aren't being what they are. It's what you think they are that they're not being, not what they are.
Let's look over to the right. We'll work round. Right to left.
Their image, which for the public at large disguised their musical skills, was that of outlaws with a hedonistic bent. They were bound to be in trouble with the law, and they often were, usually over drugs. Jagger and Richards were both jailed, briefly, in the summer of 67. And for the next 10 years, there were drug charges, usually involving Richards. In 1977, in Toronto, Richards was charged with trafficking in heroin, but given a suspended sentence and told to continue his treatment to cure heroin addiction. Since then, he says, he's given it up.
The very fact that I was a total junkie for almost 10 years leaves me now realizing that it didn't worry me too much then, because of the very nature of heroin. You know, it's nothing worries you. It goes along musician's life and always has done, you know, because of the ups and downs, the adrenaline, the energy, the making the gig the next day when you're totally drained, and it's passed on from one generation of musicians to the next, you know. And looking back on it, I'm amazed that they didn't get onto it so, a lot earlier, you know.
And at the end of all that, the band have actually survived and been transformed. What was once considered highly controversial is now mass market, big business, even family entertainment. Twenty years on, Jagger is now something of an enigmatic socialite who has no complaints about the changing attitudes of his audience.
Well, yeah, to them it's obviously different to what it was for the generation before, but I mean, yeah, there you go. I mean, I'm not going to argue with them. I mean, if they want to have a good time, then come and have a good time with us, we don't mind.
But they are not without their critics, especially after the pop music upheavals of the last 5 years. Of course, it's extraordinary that the Stones keep going and attract worldwide audiences by the million. But have they lost their early musical idealism in the process?
I think they've sold out to some degree. I think they lost the spirit of those days, you know. And I think they could have done a lot more. They could put a lot, you know, there's no harm in putting things back into things. You know.
Back in what sense?
Back into the evolution of music, back into the evolution of taste. And particularly since most of their thing was blues-based and rhythm and blues-based, they could have done a lot more to help those people.
Well, having borrowed the music from black musicians,
sure.
They could have helped black musicians back.
For instance, you know. And also, since by the time, and even now they have all this tremendous power, they could do something a little bit more constructive with it than just, you know, sort of like perpetrating of their image and their egos.
Meanwhile, the machine rolls on. In 10 days' time, the Rolling Stones end their present spate of concerts with a show at Leeds on the eve of Mick Jagger's 39th birthday. What will they do for the next 20 years?
I actually read something the other day which after those Scottish gigs which suggested that there was now no reason why the Stones couldn't be Sinatra and Bing Crosby, which I thought amazing kind of comparison. But see, the thing is with rock and roll that nobody's ever done it that long enough for the idea of older people to play it. You know, it's been, yeah, which no doubt people thought about jazz in the 20s. You know, it would be inconceivable.
Nobody thought that Louis Armstrong could keep going more than
exactly
25 or 30. Yeah.
But I mean, I played with Muddy Waters, for instance, in Chicago. And he's no young guy anymore, but he's playing as good as ever, you know, and if he can do it, sure I can, you know, given the few obvious things like not having my hands chopped off or anything.